Hello and welcome. I am Yvette Cabasa, Pediatric Reimbursement Education Specialist for the Healthy Steps National Office. Thank you for taking the time to join us today for a review of the California Healthy Steps Billing and Coding Guide. Today you will learn about the Healthy Steps Aligned services open for reimbursement under your state Medicaid agency, Medi-Cal. You will walk away knowing the open current procedural terminology codes, otherwise known as CPT codes, and healthcare common procedure codes, otherwise known as HCPCS codes, that correspond to these services. You will also walk away knowing the professional licenses eligible for reimbursement, as well as applicable Medi-Cal billing, coding, and documentation guidelines for each. My goal today is to provide a clear interpretation of the coding and billing guide's contents to facilitate compliant coding and billing to help your practice maximize insurance carrier receivables for Healthy Steps Aligned services. I have divided this presentation of the guide into four segments. Today's segment contains a review of all Healthy Steps Aligned services in the order they are listed in the guide, ending with services for smoking and tobacco use cessation. Segment two contains a review of psychotherapy services. Three will review the comprehensive perinatal service program, including lactation services when provided outside of the program. And segment four reviews the dyadic benefit and the community health worker benefit. This review of the guide was divided into these four segments where subsections may be included because of the ample time required to review its information in detail. So without further ado, fasten your seatbelts and let's begin our journey on California's Billing and Coding Guide's information highway for Healthy Steps Aligned services. First stop, applicable billing guidelines beginning with clinicians eligible for reimbursement. Medi-Cal's credentialed clinicians working under their scope of practice are eligible for Medi-Cal reimbursement. Those that can render Healthy Steps Aligned services are physicians, physician assistants, nurse practitioners, certified nurse midwives, psychiatric nurse practitioners, psychiatric physician assistants, psychiatrists, licensed clinical psychologists, licensed professional clinical counselors, licensed clinical social workers, and assistant or associate behavioral health clinicians working under clinical supervision to deliver psychotherapy services. The approved assistant and associate behavioral health clinicians that can render psychotherapy services are psychology assistants, associate marriage and family therapists, associate professional clinical counselors, and associate clinical social workers. California's Board of Behavioral Health Sciences defines the required clinical supervision of associate and assistant behavioral health providers as direct supervision, which is categorized as face-to-face contact between the clinical supervisor and the associate or assistant behavioral health provider. Weekly face-to-face contact is required and should occur within the same week of the hours claimed. The board also provides additional regulations relating to the practices of clinical supervision. And for your convenience, a website link has been provided in that section of the guide that will further aid in understanding these guidelines. Now, although these clinicians I have cited are eligible for insurance carrier reimbursement, there are factors that can impede on the reimbursement eligibility of a clinician. Factors such as the absence of credentialing a clinician with the insurance carriers, clinicians billing for services out of their scope of practice, and clinicians billing in a clinical setting where they are not contracted and recognized for reimbursement, such as at federally qualified health centers, otherwise known as FQHCs, and rural health centers, otherwise known as RHCs. Examples of clinicians that may not be eligible for reimbursement at FQHCs and RHCs are psychiatric nurse practitioners, psychiatric physician assistants, behavioral health associates, and assistants and clinical counselors. In addition, licensed marriage and family therapists may also be exempt from reimbursement, as not all insurance carrier agreements will include them as eligible service and billing providers. Verification with insurance carriers and your billing department will assist you with the guidelines applicable to your practice. Next of the guidelines for review today are the billing modifiers applicable when billing for Healthy Steps Aligned services. Medical coding modifiers are two characters composed of either alpha or numeric digits that are appended to a CPT or HCPCS code upon billing. A billing modifier does not alter the description of services rendered to a patient, but rather is used to provide additional information about the service. Applicable to HealthySteps-aligned services are modifier KX, HD, 33, and U1. Under Medi-Cal, modifier KX is used to report an autism screening because the billing code used to report these screenings is utilized to report additional developmental screenings, such as those for developmental milestones. So modifier KX has been assigned to identify and distinguish when reporting and billing for an autism screening. Modifier KX must be appended to the CPT code for the autism screening upon billing for the service. Next, there is modifier HD. Modifier HD is used to identify when billing for a maternal depression screening when rendered by a pediatrician to the mom during their infant's well-child visit. This modifier is only reported when billing for a maternal depression screening under the infant's Medi-Cal number when rendered to the mother. Modifier 33 is recognized by Medi-Cal for the reporting of a service provided in accordance with a U.S. Preventive Services Task Force A or B recommendation. With regard to HealthySteps-aligned services, this is applicable when billing for psychotherapy services provided to mothers during the prenatal period and or during the 12 months following childbirth. And last of the modifiers applicable to HealthySteps-aligned services is modifier U1, which is applicable to the dyadic benefit, which is reviewed in Segment 4 of the Billing and Coding Guide. This now brings us to the Staying Healthy Assessment, otherwise known as the SHA. The SHA, although not a HealthySteps-aligned service, consists of 7 age-specific pediatric questionnaires and 2 adult questionnaires that contains questions that are parallel to those found in validated screening tools, including those universal screening tools that are aligned with HealthySteps. It is important to understand that the SHA does not replace the required validated screening tools, but it is only an additional assessment required by the California Department of Healthcare Services. Helpful website links that offer information you may need to further your understanding of the SHA is provided in the guide. This concludes the applicable guidelines section of the Coding and Billing Guide, which brings us to the review of HealthySteps-aligned services, beginning with child developmental and social emotional screenings. Because evaluating and promoting optimal child development and well-being incorporates screenings, Tier 1 services under the HealthySteps model of care includes universal screenings. This section, as do all sections of the guide, contains a user-friendly table where one finds the CPT billing code for each service, the description of the billing code, any applicable ICD-10 codes, otherwise known as diagnosis codes, reimbursable clinicians, and applicable modifiers. Let us go ahead and dive into the screenings. First for review are developmental delay screenings, coded with CPT code 96110. This code is used to report screenings such as developmental milestones, the ages and stages questionnaire, otherwise known as the ASQ, the ASQ3, the parent's evaluation of developmental status, known as the PEDS, and the modified checklist for autism in toddlers, referred to as the MCHAT. When reporting and billing for an MCHAT screening, remember, appending modifier KX to its CPT code is required, as the modifier will distinguish it from any additional screening tools that utilize the same code for billing. There are corresponding ICD-10 codes that should be billed with CPT code 96110, which should be selected according to the type of screening rendered. Let's review them quickly. Z13.42 is the ICD-10 code that should be reported when screening for developmental milestones. Z13.41 should be reported when billing for an autism screening, such as the MCHAT, and Z13.40 should be billed when screening for an unspecified developmental delay. Screening for developmental delays and unspecified developmental delays are reimbursed when an infant is 9, 18, and 30 months, and billing for an autism screening is reimbursed when an infant is 18 and 24 months old. Documentation requirements for these screenings include the standardized tool used, the score, and how results were discussed with the patient and their family, including next steps if applicable. Fun billing fact to know is that a general developmental screening and an autism screening are reimbursable when billed on the same date of service. Medi-Cal prefers the billing of this instance by reporting its corresponding code 96110 twice on a patient's claim, where one of the listed 96110 codes has modifier KX appended. Next are the screenings are social-emotional screenings, coded with CPT code 96127. This code is used to report screenings such as the Ages and Stages Questionnaire Social-Emotional, known as the ASQ-SE, and Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder Rating Scales, commonly referred to as ADHD scales. The corresponding ICD-10 code that should be billed with the CPT code for social-emotional screenings is Z13.30, whose description reads, Encounter for screening for mental health and behavioral disorders unspecified. Medi-Cal's reimbursement for social-emotional screenings are limited to 2 per day, per provider, per patient. Documentation requirements for social-emotional screenings include the standardized test used or tool, the score and how results were discussed with the patient and their family, including next steps if applicable. With regard to the professional licenses recognized by Medi-Cal to render these screenings, physicians, physician assistants, nurse practitioners, licensed clinical social workers, licensed clinical psychologists, licensed professional clinical counselors, and licensed marriage and family therapists are recognized as reimbursable clinicians for developmental delays and social-emotional screenings. But remember, not all clinicians recognized for reimbursement for a given service will be recognized for reimbursement at your practice. Knowing those clinicians recognized for reimbursement when billing for your clinic type is very important, as seen when I reviewed those clinicians that are sometimes not eligible to receive reimbursement at FQHCs and RHCs. Always look to your administrative or billing department for guidance on those clinicians eligible for insurance carrier reimbursement. This now brings us to depression screenings. Medi-Cal will provide reimbursement for depression screenings, including postpartum depression screenings, when rendered to a mom during her infant's well-child visit. This billing opportunity provides a pediatrician with the ability to identify postpartum maternal depression, which can help prevent unfavorable developmental and mental health outcomes. A good way to track postpartum screenings would be to integrate them into the well-child visit schedule. There are 2 CPT codes used to identify when a patient either screens negative or positive for depression. The first, G8510, is used to report a negative depression screening result, and the second, G8431, is used to report a positive result. These codes are used to report screenings such as the Edinburgh Postnatal Depression Scale, referred to as the EPDS, the Patient Healthcare Questionnaire 9, simply termed the PHQ-9, and the Beck Depression Inventory, known as the BDI. Additionally, there are 2 ICD-10 codes used to identify the type of depression screening rendered. Z13.32, the first, is billed to report an encounter for the screening of maternal depression, and Z13.31, the second, is billed to report an encounter for all other depression screenings. Guidelines and frequency limitations vary for each depression screening type, so let us review the guidelines for each individually. First for review are the guidelines when billing for a postpartum depression screening when rendered to the mom by an infant's pediatrician during a well-child visit. Medi-Cal will reimburse for up to 4 maternal depression screenings rendered to the mom during the infant's first year of life. And because the screening is rendered during a well-child visit, it is to be billed under the infant, where the billing is done under his or her Medi-Cal number. Medi-Cal requires the appending of modifier HD for the reporting of a postpartum depression screening that is billed under the infant when rendered to their mother during the infant's well-child visit. The modifier's purpose is to provide Medi-Cal with identification of the postpartum screening as rendered to the mom, although it is being billed under the infant. If a postpartum depression screening happens to be rendered to the mom prior to the baby being assigned a Medi-Cal number, Medi-Cal will allow the screening to be billed under the birthing parent's Medi-Cal number for the month of the infant's birth and the following month only. Documentation requirements for a postpartum depression screening requires the HIPAA-compliant documentation of the validated screening tool, its results, and recommendations or referrals provided to the mom. For information on your practice's protocol for HIPAA-compliant documentation, please contact either your administrative, legal, or compliance department for guidance. Medi-Cal recognizes pediatricians, pediatric physician assistants, and pediatric nurse practitioners for the reporting and billing of maternal depression screenings rendered to the mom during her infant's well-child visit. Next are the depression screening guidelines for review are the guidelines when billing for a prenatal depression screening and postpartum depression screening that was rendered to a mom or mom-to-be when she too is a patient at your practice, where the billing will be done by her physician under her Medi-Cal number. Medi-Cal will reimburse for up to 2 depression screenings per year when billed under the mom. They will reimburse once when the patient is pregnant and the other when the patient is postpartum. Good news is that this frequency limitation does not include when billing under the infant's Medi-Cal number, when the postpartum depression screening is rendered to the mom during her infant's well-child visit. There are no billing modifier requirements when reporting the screening under the mom. And to support medical necessity for this screening, a pregnancy or postpartum diagnosis must be present on the claim. Medi-Cal recognizes providers of prenatal and postnatal care, such as OBGYN physicians and certified midwives, for the reporting and billing of maternal depression screenings when billed under the mom when she too is a patient at your practice. Documentation requirements include the standardized tool used, the score, any discussions with the patient, and referrals and recommendations made if applicable. Last of the depression screening guidelines for review are those for depression screenings rendered other than for prenatal or postpartum depression. Medi-Cal will also reimburse these depression screenings when rendered to patients 12 years of age and older, which includes caregivers when they too are patients at your practice. One screening per year, per provider, per patient is eligible for reimbursement. Documentation requirements include the standardized tool used, the score, any discussions with the patient, and referrals and recommendations made if applicable. The final screening for review today is the screening for adverse childhood experiences, commonly known as the ACEs screening. Because adverse childhood experiences are linked to adverse child and adult health outcomes, the ACE screening plays an important role to the Healthy Step specialist as identifying traumatic childhood events to offer supportive measures to minimize negative effects is integral to the Healthy Step specialist. There are 2 codes used to report an ACEs screening, where the pediatric ACEs and related life event screener, known as the PEARLS, is utilized. Code selection is based on the patient's screening score. The first code, G9920, is reported when the patient's score is between 0 and 3, where they are considered to be at low risk. And the second code, G9919, is reported for a screening when the patient scores 4 or greater, where they are considered high risk. Both codes require a reporting of ICD-10 code Z13.30, in addition to any other ICD-10 diagnosis codes a clinician may report. Z13.30, whose description reads, encounter for screening, examination for mental and behavioral disorders unspecified, will support medical necessity for the ACEs screening. Providers billing for ACE screenings are required to complete the California Department of Health Services training for ACEs screening and trauma-informed care. A website link has been provided in this section of the coding and billing guide where more information can be obtained about the training. Medi-Cal will reimburse for 1 screening per year per provider for patients under the age of 21, and for patients 21 years of age and over, Medi-Cal will provide reimbursement for 1 screening per provider during the patient's lifetime. Documentation requirements for the screening includes the completed screen with review, interpretation of results, discussion with patient and or family, and any appropriate clinical decisions made for further treatment if applicable. In addition to physicians, physician assistants, and nurse practitioners, Medi-Cal recognizes licensed clinical social workers, licensed clinical psychologists, professional licensed clinical counselors, licensed marriage and family therapists, as those clinicians that can render and bill for ACEs screenings. But let us not forget that prior to billing for services, it is important to know the clinicians that are recognized for reimbursement at your clinic type. This concludes the screening section of the guide, which brings us to health and behavioral assessments, reassessments, and interventions, where I think we should pull over at a rest stop, although we just started this journey. But the review of these services requires our undivided attention. Health and behavioral assessments, reassessments, and interventions often referred to as HBAI services, are used to identify and address any psychological, behavioral, emotional, cognitive, and interpersonal factors important to the assessment, treatment, or management of physical health problems. The patient's primary diagnosis is required to be physical in nature, where the focus of the assessment or reassessment is on identifying factors complicating physical medical conditions and/or treatments, and the focus of the interventions must be geared in helping improve the patient's physical health problem and well-being by utilizing psychological and/or psychosocial interventions aimed at the successful management of their physical condition. By tending to those factors that are complicating the medical condition or the treatment of the condition, or those factors that are impeding on the successful management of the condition. HBAI services are often misunderstood and have been reported incorrectly. Examples can be seen when reporting HBAI services in the absence of a physical health diagnosis or reporting the services with a mental or behavioral health diagnosis. HBAI codes are not to be reported with a mental or behavioral health diagnosis, and they are not to be reported without a physical health diagnosis. In summary, HBAI services are rendered to identify and ameliorate any of the factors that are impeding on the successful treatment and management of the patient's physical condition, such as missing appointments due to an economic factor that can be either related to transportation or housing, resulting in lack of treatment or consistent treatment for the patient's medical diagnosis. Factors can also be related to a parent not fully understanding all of the avenues of care for his or her child. For example, if the parents or caregivers of a child with bilateral hearing loss is not making their child wear their hearing aids due to the lack of understanding of its importance, then this is impeding on the care and treatment of the patient. Using the same example, let's say the same child is indeed wearing their hearing aids, but has not been in for recent appointments for aid adjustments due to the parent either not having monies for transportation or the family facing homelessness. Then these factors are also impeding on the successful treatment of the child's hearing loss. Assessments or reassessments consist of assessing multiple domains and their degree of impact, which can include a relevant medical history, adjustment to the medical illness or injury, psychological, behavioral, emotional, cognitive, and any interpersonal factors, such as environmental factors, that may be affecting the management of the condition or injury, which also includes social support and family relationships. CPT code 96156 is used to bill and report assessments or reassessments. Medi-Cal guidance tells us that they will reimburse for 96156 once per day, but limitations placed on weekly or monthly services must be verified with insurance carriers. The ICD-10 diagnosis code or codes that represent the patient's physical medical condition should be the primary diagnosis, following with the ICD-10 code that represents the factors impeding on the successful treatment or management of their physical medical condition, such as social drivers of health codes, also referred to as social determinants of health. Documentation requirements for assessments and reassessments include a health-focused clinical interview that should consist of, but is not limited to, the patient's physical condition with a relevant medical history, including health beliefs, perception, and outlook. Also, the patient's sleep patterns, diet, physical activity, and other health risk factors should be included in the documentation. Social support, family, and interpersonal relationships should also be incorporated into your documentation, as well as patient and/or family adjustment to the medical condition or injury, behavioral observations throughout the assessment or reassessment to evaluate how the patient and/or family is responding throughout, identification of the factors affecting management and or treatment of the physical condition, and integrating the information learned prior to the assessment or reassessment, when applicable, with information gained during the encounter to formulate a clinical impression and establish treatment recommendations. Next of the HBAI services for review are intervention services, which can be provided individually or in group settings or with the family unit when the patient is either present or not present during the service. Intervention services include promotion of functional improvement, by addressing those factors that are impeding on the successful treatment and management of the patient's physical health condition. There are 8 codes used to report intervention services, 4 that are independently billable, signifying that they can be billed as the only CPT code present on a claim, and 4 that are add-on codes. You may be asking yourself, what is an add-on code? Well, add-on codes are codes that can only be billed in conjunction with other codes, therefore not making them independently billable. Add-on codes can be thought of as buddy codes, created to be partnered and billed with other designated codes. I will review each intervention service individually with a review of the codes to better clarify these guidelines. First of the intervention services I will review are those provided to the family unit when the patient is present. There are 2 billing codes that represent these services. The first code, 96167, is reported when 30 minutes of intervention services are provided to a family unit when the patient is present. And 96168 is reported for each additional 15 minutes of intervention services, indicating that it is for the reporting of each additional 15 minutes of services after the initial 30 minutes were rendered. Based on the description of these codes, which would you say is the add-on code? The one created as a partner for the other? If you guessed 96168, you are correct. 96168 is the code to report any additional time rendered for the service described in billing code 96167. Therefore, 96168 could never be billed without 96167. Both of these codes are time-based codes, indicating that there is an allotted time for the rendering of services in their code's description. All time-based codes must include the documentation of the time spent rendering the service to the patient and their family. Notice I said the time spent rendering the service. I am being very specific for a reason. When coding and billing for time-based services, your calculation of the time must only be based on the time spent rendering the actual time-based service you are billing for, where the calculation of time must not include any other time spent with the patient or family during the encounter. If you report and bill CPT code 96167, which again is for 30 minutes of intervention services with the family where the patient is present, and you also report and bill code 96168, you are indicating that 45 minutes was spent rendering intervention services and your documentation must reflect as such. The ICD-10 diagnosis code that represents the patient's physical medical condition should be the primary diagnosis, following with the ICD-10 code or codes that represent the factors impeding on the successful treatment or management of their physical medical condition, such as social drivers of health codes. Documentation requirements for intervention services should include, but is not limited to, incorporating psychological interventions to ameliorate any of the factors impeding on the successful treatment and/or management of the patient's physical health condition. Psychological interventions such as motivational interviewing and problem solving, coping skills and cognitive restructuring, emotional awareness and management, mindfulness techniques, overall adjustment to the medical condition, patient outcome goals, which should be clearly identified, and not to forget, the time spent rendering the service should also be in the documentation. These documentation requirements are for all health and behavior intervention services. But when documenting for services provided to the family unit, you must also include documentation of the family members in attendance, noting their names and relationship to the patient, keeping in mind that the family members that are part of the intervention service must be directly participating in the overall care of the patient, where the intervention with the family is necessary to address the factors impeding on the treatment and or management of the patient's physical health condition. If during the intervention, a family member or members demonstrate the inability to engage or respond to cues and directions, or has enough of a cognitive defect for the intervention to be effective, or if they present with a cognitive status that indicates the inability to actively participate and benefit from services, this must also be documented, as family intervention services should no longer be provided, where further recommendations can be made at the clinical judgment of the provider. Medi-Cal will reimburse for 96167 once per day and will reimburse for up to 6 units per day of its add-on code 96168. What is this an indication of? It means that you can bill for up to 90 additional minutes of intervention services in addition to the initial 30 minutes of service, making it a total of 120 minutes, 2 hours of services that Medi-Cal will reimburse for. You may be asking yourself, how did I reach this conclusion? Well, if the description of the code reads each additional 15 minutes, such as 96168 does, then each unit of service represents 15 minutes of time rendering the service. Furthermore, if guidelines advise that up to 6 units of service is reimbursable, and you would like to know what that indicates as far as time is concerned, then you would multiply the time allotted in the description of the code, which again in this case is 15 minutes, with the maximum number of units that are reimbursable, which in this case is 6 units. And when you multiply 15 minutes by 6 units of service, you will see that it equals 290 additional minutes of service. And again, what is this in addition to? It is in addition to the time allotted in the primary code's description, which is 96167, which is for the initial 30 minutes of service. And when you add the additional 90 minutes to these initial 30, you will be billing for 120 minutes, 2 hours. Now, this is not an indication that you must bill for 2 hours of service. It is just an indication that Medi-Cal will reimburse for up to 2 hours of services per day. Let's say you want to bill for 1 hour of these services. How would you do so? Well, you will bill the primary code 96167, which is for the initial 30 minutes of service, and you will also bill for 2 units of 96168, because 1 unit is for each additional 15 minutes of service. How to utilize your EMR to bill for multiple units of service must be verified with your administrative department or IT department, as it can vary. Next of the intervention services for review are health and behavior intervention services provided to the family unit but without the patient present. The first code for these services, 96170, is reported when the initial 30 minutes of intervention services are provided to a family unit when the patient is not present. And 96171 is reported for each additional 15 minutes of intervention services after the initial 30 minutes were rendered, making 96171 the add-on code created to be partnered with 96170. And remember how add-on codes can never be billed on their own, but only in conjunction with another code? Well, in this case, 96171 can never be billed without 96170. And as seen with the codes we just reviewed for intervention services provided to the family unit when the patient is present, these codes are also time-based, indicating that the time spent rendering the service to the patient and their family must be included in your documentation. The services and documentation requirements for rendering and billing for intervention services provided to the family unit without the patient present share the same exact same criterion as when billing when the patient is present. Medi-Cal will reimburse for 96170 once per day and will reimburse for up to 4 units per day of its add-on code 96171. But before rendering and billing for intervention services without the patient present, please verify if these services are reimbursable at your practice, as some clinic types may not be eligible for reimbursement when services are rendered without the patient present. Practices such as FQHCs and RHCs are commonly known not to be eligible for reimbursement for services rendered without the patient present. The next set of health and behavior intervention codes for review are those utilized to report and bill for individual intervention services. These services are only applicable when they are being rendered directly to the patient where no one else is present. These services were added to the coding and billing guide for those practices that also provide care to mothers, fathers, and their caregivers when they too are patients at the practice, where their clinician decided they would benefit from individual intervention services. These services are billed under the patient, where the ICD-10 diagnosis code that represents the patient's physical medical condition should be the primary diagnosis listed on the claim, following with the ICD-10 code or codes that represent the factors impeding on the successful treatment or management of their physical medical condition. There are 2 billing codes that represent these services. The first, 96158, is reported when 30 minutes of individual intervention services are provided to the patient. And the second, 96159, is reported for each additional 15 minutes of services, making 96159 the add-on code created to be partnered with 96158. As seen with our previously reviewed intervention service codes, these codes are also time-based. So remember to include the time spent rendering the services in your documentation. Medi-Cal will reimburse for 96158 once per day and will reimburse for up to 4 units per day of its add-on code 96159. The services and documentation requirements for rendering and billing for individual intervention services share the same criterion as that for intervention services provided to the family unit when the patient is either present or not present, but there is one exception. Because these are individual services, family members will not be present during the intervention. Therefore, the documentation requirements regarding family members and their relationship to the patient are not applicable. And last, but certainly not least, of health and behavior intervention services are group services. Group services must consist of 2 or more patients and does not consist of family units. Group services are for individual patients that can participate. This service was added to the coding and billing guide for those practices that also provide care to the mothers, fathers, and caregivers when they tour patients at the practice. CPT codes 96164 and 96165 are used to report group intervention services. 96164 is for the initial 30 minutes of group services, and its add-on code 96165 is for each additional 15 minutes of group services. As seen with all other codes for health and behavior intervention services, group services are also time-based. And once again, all time-based codes must include the documentation of the time spent rendering the service, where the calculation of the time must only be based on the time spent rendering the actual time-based service you are billing for, which in this case would be the duration of the group session. Medi-Cal will reimburse for 96164 once per day and will reimburse for up to 6 units per day for its add-on code 96165. To continue, as seen with services when the patient is not present, group services may also not be eligible for reimbursement at all clinic types. Clinic types such as FQHCs and RHCs are sometimes not eligible for the reimbursement of group services. So again, insurance verification or verification with your billing department is highly recommended. The service and documentation requirements for group services include, but are not limited to, incorporating psychological interventions to ameliorate any of the factors impeding on the successful treatment and or management of the patient's physical health condition by using interventions such as motivational, interviewing and problem solving, coping skills and cognitive restructuring, emotional awareness and management, and mindfulness techniques. Also included in your documentation should be the patient's overall adjustment to their medical condition and the similarities the group participants have in common, whether it be any of the factors impeding on the successful treatment and or management of their physical health condition or the physical health condition itself. The goals set for the group should be identified, and the patient's personal outcome goals should also be clearly identified, although the services are being rendered in a group setting. In addition to physicians, physician assistants, and nurse practitioners, Medi-Cal recognizes licensed clinical social workers, licensed clinical psychologists, licensed professional clinical counselors, and licensed marriage and family therapists as reimbursable clinicians for HBAI services. It is important to know that physicians that are not psychiatric physicians or physician assistants that are not psychiatric physician assistants, and nurse practitioners that are not psychiatric nurse practitioners may not be eligible for reimbursement of HBAI services if reporting with HBAI codes, but they can indeed render the services, where billing a level of service code would be more appropriate. But verification with insurance carriers and your practice's billing department is highly recommended. Another important billing nuance I'd like to share with you is how other services may not be recognized for reimbursement when rendered and billed by the same clinician on the same date of service. For example, evaluation and management codes will not be considered for reimbursement if they are billed by the same clinician on the same date of service when billed with HBAI codes. The codes for evaluation and management services are better known as office visit codes or level of service codes, and they are only billable by physicians, physician assistants, and nurse practitioners. Other services that will not be considered for reimbursement when billed with HBAI service codes, if billed by the same clinician on the same date of service, are smoking cessation counseling, psychiatric diagnostic evaluations, and interactive complexity. This now brings us to the end of our review of HBAI services.